Good evening. For those who are joining us online, and there's just a small team of us in the church, and just a big welcome, and just to want to draw your attention to some notices. Our Sunday service, again, will be online only, and that from 10 to 11 on Facebook, later in the afternoon on YouTube. And we'll be looking at Saul Becomes Paul, Acts chapter 9, verses 1 to 20. It will be a service of Holy Communion. And so if you haven't already picked up fellowship cups, then they're available from Kenwell's, and you can use those then during that service. Our service next Wednesday, we'll be looking at the Sabbath, Mark chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. That's from 20 past 8 on Facebook, and then on Thursday, certainly by Thursday, it will be on YouTube. If you have any items for the food bank, then if you bring those to the rectory, and we'll make sure that they get to Enniskillen. There'll be an opportunity during our prayer time that you can pray something for yourself and something for someone who's not here. And in a way of doing that, you can put your hand over your chest for yourself and stretch out your other hand and praying for someone else. So we have our invitation to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad. Lord, direct our thoughts. Help us to pray and lift up our hearts to worship you in spirit and truth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Spirit of God fills the whole world. Come, let us worship. And we begin by singing, "The Spirit lives to set us free. Walk, walk in the light."
Oh,
So we confess our sins to God our Father. Let us pray. Together we say, Heavenly Father, Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, by what we have done and by what we have failed to do. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sin. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the Collect for the first Sunday after the Epiphany. Eternal Father, who at the baptism of Jesus revealed him to be your Son, anointing him with the Holy Spirit, grant to us, who are born of water and the Spirit, that we may be faithful to our calling as your adopted children, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our reading is from Mark's Gospel, chapter 1, beginning at verse 29. As soon as they left the synagogue, they went with James and John to the house of Simon and Andrew. Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they immediately told Jesus about her. So he went to her, took her hand and helped her up. The fever left her, and she began to wait on them. That evening, after sunset, the people brought to Jesus all who were ill and demon-possessed. The whole town gathered at the door, and Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons, but he would not let the demons speak because they knew who he was. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Simon and his companions went to look for him. When they find him, they exclaim, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else, to the nearby villages, so I can preach there also. That is why I have come." So he traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out demons. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Before the sermon, we sing, "Praise the One, and there is none like you." pray that you would speak to us through your word and by your spirit. I pray you take my lips and use them, that you'd speak through them for your name's sake and for your glory. Amen. Well, this is one of the readings that's set for today. And when we look at what the Bible teaches us, it's clear that certainly from various passages and from this verse in particular, in 1 John 2 verse 6, it says, whoever claims to live in him must walk as Jesus did. And so Jesus is our pattern for life. When it comes to difficulties with uneven ground, we're always glad when we have a tripod, particularly if you're taking photographs and you want it to be stable, because we know that a tripod, when it comes to those three legs, and you can adjust each of the legs, it means that you can get it just so that it is right, so it is level. My phone is currently on a tripod. I'm filming this service. And when we look at those three legs, I want us to be reminded about balance. Balance in our lives, because there are three things that I want to look at when it comes to Jesus and how he lived his life when he was here on earth that I believe will help us, that we will get things right in terms of balance. That tripod cannot stand without being held on one leg. Unsupported, it can't stand on two legs. It needs all three legs to be hitting the ground. And so all three of these things that we're going to look at, we need to have them together in our lives. And the first thing is upward. The upward dimension that we see in Jesus's life needs to be in ours. We're told this very early in the morning while it was still dark. Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Now, Mark tells us of Jesus praying in three times, but we know that there was a lot more than that. He says in Mark chapter 6, verse 46, he's up a mountain praying. Then in Mark 14, well, that's Jesus praying in the garden. But when we look at Luke's gospel, Luke has Jesus praying much more. And we see at his baptism, we read that Jesus was praying, and as he was praying, the Holy Spirit came down on him. Peter's confession, again, Jesus was praying, and then he asked the question of his disciples, who do the people say I am? And then as that conversation goes on, eventually Peter declares, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. At the Transfiguration, we read that as he was praying, his appearance changed. Then, of course, the Lord's Prayer. Luke 11, he was praying, and after he had prayed, his disciples come to him and they say, teach us how to pray. But we see in Luke chapter 5 verse 16 that we see that it was his pattern. But Jesus often withdrew to lonely places to pray. And so we see that his pattern of keeping things balanced and right was that there was regular communication between Jesus and the Father. He came away from situations, even though people were wanting him to pray for them, for healing and so on. He knew that it was important to spend time with the Father, to listen to the Father, to communicate with the Father. And so prayer and our communication with the Father through Jesus by the Spirit needs to be a regular pattern of our lives too. The upward dimension actually is what contributes to the other two dimensions. As we see, Acts chapter 10, when Peter is with Cornelius, Peter tells us about Jesus. And he talks about the good things that he did, that he was anointed by the Holy Spirit and with power, that he went around doing good, healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. He, as he was baptized by the Holy Spirit, as the Holy Spirit came upon him, everything that he did from that moment on, he did in the power of the Spirit. As Paul says in Philippians, he emptied himself of all but God. He didn't rely on his divine nature while he was here on earth. He relied on the power of the Spirit, so that then he could be the pattern for our lives. If he was simply living while he was here on earth as the divine being, then we could say, well, Jesus is God. But because he was relying on the Holy Spirit and the power of the Spirit, and he was living fully as a human being while he was here on earth, then he truly is our pattern for life. And if Jesus often withdrew to lonely places to pray, if that was his pattern, it has to be our pattern too. Now, not all of us are going to be getting up early while it was still dark and going off to pray, but we need to make sure that every day that there are moments where we're getting away and communicating with the Father and listening to him and hearing from him through his word and by his Spirit, that we're guided then about what to do. Then the next thing is inward. As soon as they left the synagogue, they went with James and John to the home of Simon and Andrew. And we see that Jesus, when it comes to his relationships, that there were those that he spent more time with. That we see him often going to the home of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. But also we see him withdraws with his disciples. That again, we see him, yes, with the crowd, but there are times that he actually withdraws from the crowd and he goes off with his disciples. He spends time with his disciples, teaching them, instructing them. Fellowship with his disciples is so important. And the interesting thing is that the only time that really we see Jesus is alone is when he is tempted before his ministry begins, and then when he's going to pray with the Father. There are times, yes, when the Bible tells us that Jesus was alone, but the rest of the time he was with people. And so he gives us a model of how we need to be as Christians, that we're not meant to be isolated, we're meant to be with other people. And it's difficult in these times that we need to then see new ways of having fellowship, new ways of connecting with people, because otherwise our lives are not going to be in balance. We're not going to be living the way that we're meant to be like Jesus. And so I would encourage you, arrange to phone maybe someone to say, right, I'm going to phone you, either we'll have a coffee together on the phone, or maybe you know that there's a particular time that someone's having a meal and you say, well, can I phone you when you're having your meal? And we'll have a meal together. We'll be separate, but we'll talk over the phone. And there's that sense of that we're having meals together with other people, even though we're separate. And that's so important, particularly for those who are feeling isolated at this time. That we can be those who connect with those who are feeling isolated and help them to feel that they're having times of fellowship with other Christians. You can chat about what you've read and listened to. Either you've read from the Bible or you've listened to things online. Share those things with others. Pray together over the phone. Let's look at ways that we can make sure that even in the lockdown, we're still being those who have a balanced life. We're still having that inward dimension, that we're not just connecting when it comes to our online services, but we're connecting with others outside of that. And the last thing is outward. Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else to the nearby villages so I can preach there also. That is why I have come." So he traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out demons. We see Jesus was very clear about why he had come, and that even though the people were trying to persuade him to stay where he was, he knew he had to go and preach to others also. There was a message that he wanted to give people. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near, was a key message that he wanted to give people, but he also demonstrated that the kingdom of heaven was near by healing people, by driving out demons, by showing power being of the kingdom coming into our present evil age. Jesus was bringing the kingdom in through different things. The king himself was among us and showing what the kingdom is like. And so for us, when it comes to our outward, it can be difficult again in these times to think of how we can be outward in terms of our mission. But we know that you can meet up with one other person and you can walk with those. You can have exercise with one other person. And so if what you do, even if it's not doing it with another person, but even as you go for a walk, we know that we can't go, or we're not supposed to be going any further than 10 miles to have exercise. So that means we're focusing in more on the place where we're living. So when you walk, why not pray for the people that you're passing, the homes you're passing, the places where you live? Pray for God's blessing upon your neighbors. Pray for the places where you are. That whenever all of this ends, I believe that there, if people are doing that, if they're praying for their neighbors and praying for the areas that they're walking around, that we will see amazing things happening even during this time. But I believe that there will be a harvest after it too. That we'll be laying a great foundation for a work of God when we pray for the places that we're living. And we can do that as we walk. Either you walk with someone else and you pray. You can, Joanna and I, sometimes we, when we're walking, we're praying as we walk, and people probably thinking we're talking to each other, but actually we're talking to God as we walk. And you can do that. And it doesn't look silly as long as you walk with your eyes open and don't close them. You know the way that I used to hate when people talked about you shut your eyes or the devil will steal your prayers, and it's such an error. We can pray with our eyes open and we can use this time wisely. And so in conclusion, let's regain the balance of life. Let's be those who make sure that all three legs are hitting the ground. That we are those that even though we're in this uneven time, a time of difficulty, where it seems like the road is rough, that if we have something with three legs on it, we know that it will keep balance. And so if we have that upward, inward, outward in our lives, we will be those who are living like Jesus with balance. And hopefully then others will see that there's something different about our lives too. And so let's pray. Father, we do want to pray that you'd help us, Lord, to regain the balance in our lives, that even though the situation is very different to how we would like it to be, Lord, help us that we would have those three dimensions in our lives, the upward, the inward, and the outward. Lord, as we walk around, as we pray, would you open up our eyes, that we would see the needs in our area. And as you, Lord, met the immediate needs of people that you came across, so that then you pointed to that you could meet the needs beyond that, their eternal needs. Lord, would you help us that we would be those who meet the immediate needs of those around us too. And that we would point then people to you, the one who can meet all their needs. We ask this in your name. Amen. So we sing it, there is an everlasting kindness. So we affirm our faith to believe and trust in God the Father, I believe and trust in God the Father, who made the world. Do you believe and trust in God the Son? I believe and trust in His Son, Jesus Christ, who redeemed mankind. Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit? I believe and trust in the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God. This is the faith of the Church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we have our prayers of intercession. Let us pray.
Thank you, Lord, as we read in Psalm 10, verse 17, that you hear, O Lord, the desire of the afflicted, that you encourage them and you listen to their cry. We give you thanks, Lord, for a series of extraordinary developments in Sudan since moderate Muslims gained political control in April 2019 after almost 30 years of extreme Islamic rule under strict Sharia law. We pray that the signed declaration on the 27th of October, aimed at promoting peace and freedom of religion, will be followed by real and practical developments to implement it. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Sovereign Lord, as Ugandans go to the polls tomorrow to vote for their next president, we pray for peaceful, fair and just elections, and that the right person will be in position to help them make positive progress as a nation, and that will benefit all the people, especially the poor and marginalised. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of health and healing, we pray for those who work in the NHS and in health services across the world. We ask for protection from the effects of the coronavirus and a lifting of exhaustion as they continue to deal with the ongoing challenges of this global pandemic. May their efforts and sacrifices be valued by all, whether a patient or a grateful community. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. We pray for those who we know who are sick. And at this time, we pray for Florence, for Jean, and for Claire. Now, in the silence, pray something for yourself and something for someone who's not here. Accept our prayers through Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our final hymn is, "Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing, my dear Redeemer's praise." have our closing prayers. Lord Jesus Christ, you emptied yourself, taking the form of a servant. Through your love, make us servants of one another. Lord Jesus Christ, for our sake you became poor. May our lives and gifts enrich the life of your work. And we say together, Lord Jesus Christ, I thank you for the benefits you have given me, for all the pains and insults you have borne for me. O most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother, may I see you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day. Amen. And we say the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all, evermore. Amen. So every blessing, and Lornette is going to play us out.